Amen. Amen. Misunderstanding. It's comforting. But let me ask you. But let me interject this real quick. It's comforting. See, this is not a... See, we're dealing with this when we come here. But these are issues of the heart. Why is it... It's a comforting thing. Because we all can share the same stories. I mean, I have an aunt who believes the same thing. Married to an uncle for 39 years. That's a long time to be with somebody. Right? He dies and she still tells my dad that he comes back to visit. Why is this dangerous? If we leave them in their comfort, why is it dangerous? That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's what's going to happen. And guess what? It's going to happen to Adventists too. Okay? So just the fact that you know this truth is not good enough. Not good enough. That's right. Right. Good morning. You're absolutely right. Absolutely right. But we have to say something anyhow. And what we have to do, and this shows true trust, I'm not going to cut you off. This shows true trust in Christ, is that at that moment, we have to pray. Because even those short prayers, he hears them. He heard Peter presumptuous jump on that water and say, Lord, he has his eyes on Christ. And all of a sudden he starts to sing and he says, Lord, save me. That's a fast prayer in the Bible. But he heard it. And he'll hear yours too. Because these things, your coworker that you're talking about, the situation with your stepdaughter, these are things that he wants us to do. So you can pray for $1 million and there's no way in Scripture that's really going to come to you. That's not what he's really. But these things you guys are praying about, oh yeah, he wants you, clear cut in Scripture. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. Let's keep moving. Let's go to hope of resurrection. Hope of resurrection. Okay, we're looking at page 98 in your Sabbath school lesson. But if you don't have your Sabbath lesson, never fear. We're looking at John chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. John chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. I want us to look at these texts. Sometimes the Lord uses the text that we know very well to reveal truths to us that we might have not concentrated on as deeply. Okay? So we're looking at John. We're talking about the hope of resurrection. And there's a question here that I'm going to read first, and then we're going to look at the text. Okay? It says, what is implied in these verses? What is implied in these verses that shows us the power of Jesus to raise the dead? So as we look at John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, what's implied? I'm talking to all of us. This is all Sabbath school today. All right? It says, John chapter 1, verse 1 through 4, says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I'm going to stop right there. Okay, so we have in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What's he trying to tell us right there? That he's the Word, that he's with God, and he has the same authority as God. You see that? Three things he's trying to show us. And then, if you didn't get it, he says it again. He says, the same was in the beginning with God. So these are two separate. They're separate. Because he says he's with the person. Right? And then he makes it clear that this individual has authority. Because he's also God. He says that in verse 1. He says, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. If you have any question on that, look at Colossians. Because it's in Colossians as well. I believe it's Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 or 17. It says, by him all things consist. Right? It says, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. So, he's a creator. And then verse 4 says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. So, in who was life? In Jesus Christ is life. We're going to see that. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. That's just 1 through 4 right there. Good morning, gentlemen. Good to see you guys. All right. So, back to the question, ladies. What's implied in these verses that shows us the power of Jesus to raise the dead? In other words, can we see the power of Jesus to raise the dead in these verses that we just read? Because he's God. He's a creator. Okay. You guys got it. You guys got it. All right. Christ has life in himself, for he is the life. Then it says, he created everything and has a power to give life to whom he wills. We've read that before. Thus, Jesus can raise the dead. And then the other question here says, how does the resurrection happen? Now, I really want, time is of short essence, and I really want to get to the story of Lazarus. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to jump to the story of Lazarus, if y'all don't mind. This is a powerful story, and I think the story of Lazarus is going to encompass everything. I don't, how much time do I have? Okay. All right. Let's go to the story of Lazarus really quick. We're going to skip to Thursday. We don't have like a lot of time, so I really want to get this in. It says, Jesus conquered death. Because Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 7 says, blessed is the man in whose hope the Lord is. Blessed is the man whose hope the Lord is. Very short text, but it says volumes. See, our hope is not to be in Christ. Christ is to be our hope. You follow me? See, important distinction. Most people tell you your hope has to be in Christ. Uh-uh. Christ has to be our hope. You follow me? No? This is what we call trusting. See, if my hope is in Christ, if my hope is in Christ, let's say that I expect the Lord to do this for me. I expect the Lord to do that. My grandmother's sick, and I expect the Lord to raise my grandmother back to life, or you know, bring her back to health is what I'm really saying. If the Lord doesn't do exactly as I had hoped, you've seen people and it break their faith, right? But Christ has to be our hope. Not my hope is in him, but he is my hope. And that's where the Lord wants to take us. Because our hope, if our hope is in Christ, if Christ is our hope, Christ raised it from the dead. Christ conquered death. And he's coming back again. And what he's saying is, he is the faithful one. He will not let us down. Okay. And then we're going to see that. Let's go to John chapter 11. John chapter 11. This is a powerful, powerful story. Probably the most powerful story, in my opinion, in all of Scripture, is John chapter 11. Due to the interest of time, I'm just going to read part of this. Okay? I would encourage you to read it on your own. Lazarus was not only a good friend of Christ, he was a disciple of Christ. They were close, very, very close. And before Lazarus, Christ had raised two other people from the dead, but the Pharisees had said negative things. In other words, the Pharisees had said, well, this person wasn't really dead that long. He rose this other person up by powers that were not of God. So Christ waited on this one. Four days Lazarus was dead. And they didn't have the embalming methods that we have today. You know, embalming methods we have today, a person, you know, once they've embalmed them, the person can be dead for a while and you won't tell, you know. But they didn't have that back then. You know, they had spices and whatnot. And it may last a couple hours, but that was about it. So 4 days, this man had been dead. And the big wonder in everyone's mind was, this man is your friend, Christ. Why are you waiting so long? Even the disciples wondered that. Why are you waiting so long? He waited 4 days. So then, look at it. Chapter 11, verse 12. We can start with verse 12. The disciples said, verse 11, Christ had told the disciples, he said, Lazarus is asleep. Then the disciples said to him, Lord, if he's sleepy, he shall do well. And then Christ said to them, Lazarus is dead. He's dead. Okay? I don't want to read because we don't have like a lot of time. We'll keep going down. And many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them. And then Mary, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him. But Mary still sat in the house. Martha and Mary are sisters. And then it said, Martha went to Jesus and she said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. So she does have a faith in Christ. She says, Lord, if you had been here, he wouldn't even die. And then she says, but I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, he will give it to thee. So she has some faith in Christ. Okay? Look at verse 23. Then Jesus said to her, thy brother shall rise again. Your brother's going to rise. Now, see, we have to picture this in our mind's eye. And that's why I would encourage everybody, read the story of Lazarus in this book. She paints it with a picture that is undeniable. See, it's one thing, we are secondhand readers. You follow me? We're reading this story secondhand. But it's one thing when you're actually in the pain of having lost a loved one and you have to exercise faith in Christ. That's when the rubber really meets the road, right? I mean, it's one thing to read about somebody else's story, but it's another thing when you're going through it, you've lost a loved one, and God tells you your brother's going to rise again. But you have to keep your faith in Christ even in those difficult times. And guess what, folks? The difficult times are here. Okay. Then she says to him, he says to her, your brother shall rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. So she knows Scripture. Then look at verse 25. He says, Jesus said to her, I am. He didn't say I have the resurrection. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Important, powerful distinction. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. But and he says, believeth thou this? He asked, do you believe this? And then she said to him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. So she gets a little bit of what he's saying, but not totally. And I say all this, well, I'm reading this because it's a really powerful story, because you have the mourners. If you could just picture in your mind's eye, I'm going to paint the picture that Ellen White would paint, okay? You have the mourners over here, some of them who are mourning, who are not really mourning for Lazarus. They're there because that's the culture. Whenever you had someone die, you had to have mourners, and sometimes the mourners were paid, but they would come along and cry and just be an obstruction. Then you have the disciples over here, and even some of the disciples have said some negative things. You have, in this story, Thomas, which is called Didymus, he said something negative. So Christ has listened to the mourners. Christ has Martha, who's really hurting right here. Then Mary comes out to greet him. And he's seeing all this, and the Bible says he groans in his spirit because it's so heavy on him. Then Christ prays a prayer. He says, Father, I thank you for hearing me. And he said it loud enough for the Pharisees to hear, so they would know that he's praying to his Father, that the power comes from the Father, right? And then he tells Lazarus, come forth. And I obviously I don't see it. I read about it. But to me, I love that because it kills everything. You can't say anything after that. The naysayers have seen it. The disciples have seen it. The man comes from the grave. And when you read Desire of Ages, she says some pretty important, powerful truths. She said Christ could have had his angels, who were right there, invisible. She said he could have had the angels come and roll away the stone, but she says he chose not to. She said that God expects the human to work with the divine. In other words, whenever God gets ready to do a miracle, he wants you to work with him. See, the angels can come down and do everything for us, but he wants us to work with them. This gospel is not like anything else you can ever imagine, because what God does is God wants us to work with him in this process. And by giving this gospel, you receive it. You get it by receiving it. So the more we give, the more we receive of Christ. Doesn't make sense to us in earthly wise, but it makes sense about Bible wise. So he tells them to roll away the stone. He tells his disciples that, roll away the stone. And then he says, because his word, the Bible says, in him is life. So his words, he says, Lazarus, come forth. The man comes from the grave. I could go on and on about that story. I really love it. But we're going to cut it short. But I would encourage you, if you're studying and you really want to know this word, and also, along with the sermon that we had last week, really getting to know Christ, spend some time with this. Get Desire of Ages. Read this, the chapter on Lazarus. It's only about 8 pages long. Read it. She paints a powerful picture you feel like you're there. Anyway, I'll pray. Heavenly Father, we want to say thank you so much for the Word of God. I pray, Lord, that you will move on each and every heart, including my own, to study this word and to read the spirit of prophecy. Give us a deep desire for it. Make us hungry for it, Father, that we'll read your word and the spirit of prophecy, and we will fall in love with Christ. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Justin. That was a really nice Sabbath school lesson. Welcome to Sabbath School, the second part. I know this has been a wonderful lesson. We're almost done with the quarter. That always makes me sad, especially when we just get started in it. As you can see, I'm not Jezreel Herrera, but she's family to me, and so I am going to take her place right now. So I do want to welcome everyone, and I don't see any visitors, so we just are all here. Praise the Lord. And we're going to open our Sabbath school with singing Wonderful Words of Life, as we read in John. Page 286, and we will sing first and last song, stanza. Please stand if you are able. The truth. Beautiful words of life. We were studying that today in Sabbath school. So I want to read the scripture from John chapter 1, 1 through 5. If you'll follow ahead, follow with me. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Solemn words in verse 5, because God is trying to show us every day that he is the light. We got to open our eyes, people, because the end is coming sooner than we think. We just have to look around us, turn on the news. Everything that's happening right now was predicted in Matthew and the Revelations and Daniel. Now think about it, Daniel was long before Jesus was ever here. And the things that are happening right now, it's time to go to the light and spread that light so that Jesus may come. Christ is coming with clouds and with great glory. A multitude of shining angels will attend him. He will come to raise the dead and to change the living saints from glory to glory. He will come to honor those who have loved Him and kept His commandments and to take them to Himself. He has not forgotten them, nor His promise. He has not forgotten you or me. There will be a relinking of the family chain. Praise the Lord. Brother Amjad, can you start? We're going to have our mission sunlight now. Oh, you know what I didn't do? I didn't open with prayer. I'm sorry. Shall we bow our heads? Father God, we want to give thanks to you. I want to thank you for the Sabbath day that you have blessed us with. You gave it for us for rest and for rejuvenation. Father, put life into us that we may share with others. Give us your word in our hearts and in our minds that we may not sin against thee. Father in heaven, thank you for all here. Please bless each one. Bless the pastor and Sister Burrow. They came back safely to us. We thank you. And we ask that as he breaks bread with us, your word, Lord, that we will hear and that we will belong to you and that we will share what we learn and that we will live what we learn and that we will be what we learn. Thank you, Jesus. In thy blessed name we ask. Amen.
From the Network 7 Media Center studios, this is Mission Sunlight, reporting from the city of Kazan. Kazan is the capital of the Republic of Tatarstan, located 500 miles east of Moscow and 500 miles west of the Ural Mountains. Kazan's population is just over 1 million people from both Muslim and Christian faiths. In recent years, the historical center of Kazan, which includes their own Kremlin, has been undergoing renovation. Celebrating its millennium in 2005, there were many commemorative events. The largest mosque in Russia was dedicated, a new metro system was put into operation, and a millennium bridge was built over the Kazanka River. The city is considered Russia's sports capital and has been host to major stadium events in the years since the 1,000-year anniversary.
The rich historical city of Kazan is on the move, and as you'll see today, the church is moving with it.
Known as Russia's third capital after Moscow and St. Petersburg, Kazan is home to its own Kremlin. It has become an inter-regional political, sports, tourism, and financial center. Youth here are predominant in many facets of city life, connecting largely with their study and sports. These youth desire a place to worship in the city that is near their schools and stadiums. The Seventh-day Adventist Church in Kazan is ready to meet this need and is asking for your support through this 13th Sabbath World Mission Offering.
There are just over 3,000 members in our conference, covering six central regions of Russia. Our numbers are few, but we have the freedom now that we did not have before to reach our brothers and sisters, including Muslims and Orthodox faiths. We are conducting health and temperance seminars and parenting workshops. We have campus outreach to our young adults. Doing this work in the area of our church gives us Bible study interest that we can invite to join us.
Other denominations are better known because they have a convenient location in the center of the city. Some are just a few minutes' walk from the popular attraction of the Kazan Kremlin. The Kremlin itself is home to a large and beautiful mosque. It is evident that location is critical to the expansion of the gospel in Kazan. Understanding this principle, the members are preparing the central city community even before they begin building the new church at this location. They know it will take faithful prayer and patience to truly be a center of influence in the great city.
While the church has been meeting for 70 years, there is no public transportation and it is difficult to access for university students and youth whose parents do not support their faith. There are two other groups meeting in the city in rental facilities. These faithful believers are often forced to migrate around the city on the whim of their landlords.
The pastors and leading laymen have met to pray and plan. They know that they must be tightly connected to God in order to lead the membership into that same trusting relationship. But they also know that God is evidently working in the lives of these laity, and they are encouraged.
I am a general contractor in Russia. My family and I lived far outside of Kazan for several years until recently. Where we lived before, I had the opportunity to build a new church. It had all of the technological conveniences, and it was architecturally pleasing. Our friends wanted to visit the church, and when they came, we had an adequate place for their worship experience.
Ildar explains that he moved his family to the city so that his children could attend university and live at home, that he wanted to grow his business, and also to help the Kazan membership build a new house of worship.
Look at the vacant lot here. It has some old buildings and trash on it now, but we will clean up this messy place. Our youth will come and help with the project because they are ready for this church.
Ildar tells us why they picked this site.
You can see the buses drive right down the street, and the metro station is just a few meters away. We are close to the university and stadiums. The location isn't perfect, but it is much better than the old building. It will be a light on a hill in the middle of our city.
Currently, there is one Adventist prayer house on the outskirts of Kazan. There are 76 mosques in the city, but there is a plan in place to change that, one house of worship at a time.
You can see our plan here. This is a plan that is attractive to our neighbors. We will build the church first, and then we are going further. We will build a community playground on the front of the property. Our young families will meet other moms and dads when they bring their children to play in the park. We can share our faith and invite them to visit us. From this center of influence, we will grow and build more.
I represent the moms of our church. We are very excited that we will have a safe place for our children to play. When we come to the park, we will sing and witness. Our moms and dads have an intentional desire to meet other families. They will come from our neighborhood, and we will invite them from other parts of the city. Together, we will share with them our hope.
Some members have sold property to invest in what they term their gospel ministry. They have chosen their work carefully and prayerfully. There is a sense that God is not about to do something, but He is presently doing something in them. People are asking about the new church. Parents are seeking the new playground. Young adults are hopeful they can attend church again near their schools. This hope stems from not only what the members have committed to, but also what you will do this 13th Sabbath.
Thank you to each brother and sister who give to help us reach our youth, to reach Muslims, to reach the people of Kazan. Because of your gifts and our work here, there will be a new church in the center of the great city of Kazan.
I am already visiting with moms and dads. They are interested in what we are doing. Our dreams will come true one day. We will have our church, a playground, a way to minister to other moms. Thank you for helping make this dream a reality.
Uniting the Seventh-day Adventist Church through the 13th Sabbath offering, this is Mission Sunlight, reporting this week from Kazan. We are the media missionaries of Network 7 Media Center.
Praise the Lord. May I have two deacons? Or junior deacons. That's good. I just want to say next week is 13th Sabbath, and you heard what the gentleman on the Mission Sunlight said. The offering that you roll up, all your change you've been saving to give to 13th Sabbath, that will go there to help them to be a light unto the world. Bow our heads. Father God, we thank you so much for all that you give to us. I just want to hold up that country at this time and the people that are building this church. I pray, Father, that they will get the funds that they need to build hope, to build a life for other people to know you and to share that with them. Please bless them abundantly. Bless us. And our blessings may we give back, Lord Jesus. Please bless this offering for the glory of thy name and the good of thy will. In thy name I pray. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. It looks like people are not happy to be here this morning. Happy Sabbath, everyone. That's better. I'm happy that all of us made it safely here to the house of God. And God has led us through the week. Because if you listen to the news these days, you will think you will never go anywhere because of the things. But when it's Sabbath, it is a time to be happy. It is a time to glorify the Lord. These are the few announcements that we have for today. Glad to welcome Sister Mama Noah. Amen. Nice to see you sitting on that seat. Please continue to pray for all the people listed in the bulletin. And also for all our church members. We all need prayers from each other at this time. There will be communion service next week. And usually when I was little, in those days, they give us at least 2 weeks, 3 weeks in advance to prepare for that service. It's not something we take casual. Please prepare for the communion service next week so that you will enrich yourself with the blessings that God gives for that particular service. I'm asked also to remind you that there will be potluck after morning service this afternoon. Please, all who are here are welcome to stay. We will have our bi-monthly Bible studies today. Actually, we are starting on a new topic today. Please, if you want to spend at least 1 hour to know what the Lord is telling us to do, these are important lessons that also has to rhyme with the time that we live now. Please, if you have time, please join us after the service.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Next Sabbath is communion. It's also 13th Sabbath, and it's the tradition that the youth department put on the 13th Sabbath program. So I'm asking that all youth, parents, grandparents, loved ones, we will have a meeting to gather our program rehearsal this coming Friday here at this church at 6:30. Please bring your young people. We're going to be studying out of the story of Samson. So parents and loved ones of our young people, if you can get them prepared, I'm asking that they start reading the story of Samson, which is found in the book of Judges, chapters 13 through 16. And so, next Friday. Yes. Also, on that same day, for the all of the youth as well, after our 13th Sabbath rehearsal, we're going to have Vespers here. We're still preparing for, can you come up? We're still preparing for the Quizarama that will be held the weekend of October the 11th in Stockton at the African American Convocation. We have started studying the book of Acts, and we will continue that today, and Josephine will tell you more about that. So after next Friday's rehearsal, we will then have Vespers and we will continue our study in the book of Acts.
Would you like to let them know the time at Quizarama?
Well, it's actually a worship service first. So, and I would advise all of us who are participating, and that's our older youth, are preparing for the Quizarama. Again, I mentioned last Sabbath that we did so very well earlier this year in preparing for the book of Genesis. Now it's in Acts. So the actual convocation is an entire weekend, starting actually Friday evening. They have a vesper service. The youth won't be participating in Quizarama until that Sabbath afternoon. I didn't bring my phone up here, so I don't have the address, but I will give that to you next Sabbath. It is in Stockton, so my advice is just to just spend the day there, at least, if not Friday. I usually go on Friday nights. But the Quizarama will start in the afternoon, I believe around 4 o'clock. It would be wonderful to just have the whole experience for that day. They have children's church. They have for the young people. Then they have a youth church. Then they have the adult service. So it's a wonderful time. And so please come out. But those of the youth who are participating, I hope that you would come that morning just to, you know, be there. And we'll all be gathered and prepared for the Quizarama.
Thank you, Sister Bunny. Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. I hope every youth will be participating in on the Bible Quizarama, because it's going to be exciting. Amen. As we continue to study the book of Acts, this afternoon we are going to have our monthly AYS program after potluck. After the adult Bible lesson, so it's going to be at 3 p.m. and we are going to study about again the book of Acts for the preparations for the Quizarama. So I hope to see you, and please continue to support our youth. Remember that these young ones are the next generations of our pastors and ministers. So I hope to see you there. I hope to see you this afternoon. Thank you.
I also want to say thank you to our church. We had a few church members and their families. We've had a few elders and their families come out to the senior dedication at Pleasant Hill Church last night. Continue to pray for our students. Specifically, continue to pray for our seniors. Thank you.
And just a couple more announcements coming from Community Services. I am very grateful for the coats that we have been receiving from you. As you know, we at Community Service will be distributing coats to the homeless this year. And we have received some beautiful, nice coats, and I know they'll be so pleased to get them. So they can keep coming, because you know there's lots of people out there that need coats. The other thing I have, we're doing something a little bit different this year in Community Services. We are going to have Thanksgiving boxes, which we have every year, I know, but we won't be having Christmas boxes this year. So I need a list. And I need it by October 15th. How many church members need a Thanksgiving box? Please let me know, or someone in Community Services know, because you will be added to our client list. And I have to have that, because we're only going to do, you know how in the past we did 85 baskets, 65, 35. Well, we are going to only do 25, and then plus whatever church members needs them. So please, please don't let me know at the very last minute, because there won't be, you know, one for you. So just let me know if you need one or you know somebody that needs one. Okay, and that's in October. The other thing I have, as you know, we'll be getting our new quarterlies. I've passed several out today. We have cut our order in half. So I want to make sure all the members get their new quarterly. So if you haven't got your quarterly yet, please let me know. And then whatever we have left, our visitors will be welcome to share them with us. Thank you, and have a happy Sabbath.
As we sit reverently for the next service, may the Lord bless all who are here and those who are on the way. God bless you.
We are so thankful and grateful for this opportunity to be in your holy sanctuary, to worship you, Lord. So may your Spirit awaken in us the sense of awareness and importance and the joy of being able to worship you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue praising our loving Lord by singing in hymnal 619, lead on, O King Eternal. 619, lead on, O King Eternal.
Grounds.
Thank you, and be seated, please.
Please, could you open with me in the Bible, in your Bible, if you don't have any, there are some in the pew. Open with me 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we are going to start from verse 14 through 21. For the love of Christ constrains us, because we judge thus, that if God died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors of Christ, as though God was pleading through us. We implore you in Christ's behalf to be reconciled to God. The last verse, verse 21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become righteous of God in him. May the Lord add blessings to his word. Amen. We are now going to prepare for prayer. You can come forward if you have a prayer request or thanksgiving. We shall sing hymn 671. Our Father in heaven, our gracious, loving God. We have no business to be here today, but you have made it possible for us to be here considering everything that goes on around us and in our lives. You spared our lives on the way, in our homes. You bless us far more than we deserve. Thank you for allowing us to come to worship and to praise you this morning. Thank you for your holy Sabbath day, a day we cast all our sorrows, all our cares away and rejoice in this day you've set aside for us. We are thankful, O Lord, for all our family that is here today. Amen. We are thankful for the blessing that we did not receive any disheartening news of any of us over this past week. Thank you for the blessings far beyond what we can ever give thanks for. This morning, before, we just want to thank you and praise you because you have been so good to us. Oh Lord, there are few that have come, some that have come this morning with prayers, for prayers, for personal reasons. You know the height and the depth of their hearts. And you are the only one who can sustain everything that we ever need. Bless them, O Lord, and fill their needs. Bless the men and women of this church. Father, we see things you've told us that will happen. So prepare us, O Lord, so that when we see some of these things around us, we can be happy knowing that your word is true. Knowing that you never said anything that you didn't mean. That prophecies are being fulfilled in our own eyes. Thank you for all our children, those who are in school. Father, they need your wisdom and knowledge. Not just to do well in school, but to be good men and women of the future. Father, take care of their needs. Help them never to be swayed away by peer pressures, but to look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of their faith. Amen. Father, I just want to thank you this morning, especially for our pastor and their sister, Mama Noah. You gave them traveling messages going to Indonesia. Father, you brought them home safely. They went there to cast the Lord for souls.
Amen.
And we are thankful that they are here this morning and that you took care of their movements. And we are thankful for every blessing. Please be with us today. As Pastor breaks the bread of life to us, may it touch our hearts so that the words that he speaks today will be words that will arouse in us thinking of our own lives and how to make amends and wait for your soon coming. Father, bless us as we worship you today. We have come empty, but fill us up with your goodness, with your Holy Spirit, and with your blessings as we live. And for the letter today, on all the activities, may everything that we do today be to your honor and to your glory.
Amen.
And we ask all these, O Lord, plus all the unspoken requests, may you fulfill them in accordance with your will. For we ask in Jesus' holy name. Let the church say, Amen. Amen.
Church.
Good morning.
It's now time for our worship through giving. Today's offering is for our local church budget. Ellen White once spoke to a church about the importance of paying tithe. As the sin of robbing God was presented, the people received clearer views of their duty and privilege in this matter. One brother said that for 2 years he had not paid his tithes and he was in despair. But as he confessed his sin, he began to gather hope. "What shall I do?" he asked. I said, "Give your note to the treasurer of the church. That will be businesslike." He thought that was a rather strange request, but he sat down and began to write. "For value received, I promise to pay." He looked up as if to say, "Is that the proper form in which to write out a note to the Lord?" "Yes," he continued, "for value received, have I not been receiving the blessings of God day after day? Have not the angels guarded me? Has not the Lord blessed me with all spiritual and temporal blessings? For value received, I promise to pay the sum of $571.50 to the church treasurer." After doing all he could to do his part, he was a happy man. In a few days, he took up his note and paid his tithe into the treasury. God blesses those who are faithful in returning their tithe to his church. Let us determine to be faithful stewards by giving back to his storehouse. We have so many blessings that we don't even realize unless we sit down and start writing them out. You'll be amazed how many you'll have on that paper when you're done. If the deacons would please come forward. We'll say a prayer. Please bow your heads. Dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you for the wealth that you give us. Yes, the wealth. Not that we are rich per se, Father, in coin, but the wealth of our healthy lives, our families, the roof that you put over our heads, the health that we have to go work our jobs and earn this money, and the privilege of working with you, giving back to spread your words to all who need to know you. Please bless these tithes this day. May they spread far and wide and bring many souls to the cross and to you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see all your pretty young faces. Ms. Jones is going to be here this morning. She was sick, so I am filling in for her. So let's keep her in prayer. So I have a question for you. What is half of a dollar? Yes, my, yes. Pleasant Hill Education, people. Pleasant Hill Education. Half a dollar is 50 cents. Yes. What if I told you you had a 50-50 chance of being born healthy? Is that a good ratio? Yeah, maybe, no. What if I told you the 50-50 chance of being a professional athlete? Is that a good ratio? Yeah, it's a little better. What if I said a 50-50 chance of getting a PhD? Is that a pretty good ratio? That's pretty good. I think it's probably less than that people will actually make it. The Bible talks about, has a story in Matthew chapter 25 of a situation where there was a 50-50 chance. And it's the parable of the 10 virgins. And as we discussed in Sabbath School the last couple of weeks in the youth class, the 10 virgins weren't just normal people. They were they're talking about just Christians in general. The 10 virgin story is not talking about people outside the church, but people who are inside of the church. And they all had knowledge of the Lord. How many of us here have knowledge of the Lord? Raise your hand. Even adults, knowledge of the Lord? Any of us? Maybe? Kind of? A little bit? But in the parable of 10 virgins, of all the 10 Christians that fell asleep, only 5 had enough knowledge and kept enough of a close relationship with God to go in with the bridegroom when he came. Now, if I said you had a 50-50 chance today of making it home safely, would that be a good percentage? Yeah, you nod your head, huh? You're like, take that chance, huh? And we look around the church, as the Lord came down today and looked at our church, of those who are inside church today, and said, 50% of you are going home with me and 50% of you aren't. Is that a good chance? Is that a good percentage? No. Because 50-50, even though in some instances you walk into a casino, they said, hey, everyone today has a 50-50 chance of leaving here with $1 million, there'll be a lot of people at that particular casino today. But when you're thinking from a spiritual point, 50-50 is not a good chance. Especially when we're talking about 50% of God's chosen people. How many of us study the Bible on a weekly basis? Raise your hand. How many of your parents read to you the Bible? Yeah, I remember. Yeah, Jaden, yes. Jaden, your parents put a video of you quoting a scripture at your young age. I said, praise the Lord. 4 verses, right, Jaden? Yeah. So your mom studied the Bible with you? And he says it with a smile. Amen, amen. So in the story of the 10 virgins, it said, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto a virgin which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. If we have lamps and lamps need oil, how do we fill our lamps with oil spiritually? How do we fill our lamps with oil spiritually? Yeah. You don't know? How about prayer? How many of us pray? Ye? All right. Can we fill our oil with Bible study? Yeah. Can we fill our oil with spreading the good news? Yeah. Okay. Let's move on. Can we fill our oils with our personal behaviors? Yeah. Can our behavior keep us from filling our oils? Yeah. Can our behavior keep us out of heaven? Yeah, kind of. Maybe a little bit. So in the story of the 10 virgins, if you've ever read it or if you've never read it, you can go to Matthew chapter 25, and verse 13 says, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour when the Son of Man cometh. So, after reading that, should we keep our spiritual lamps full every day? Yeah. We should commune with God every day, right? In fact, one of the spiritual books I read with the baptismal group said that our spiritual life is like a flourishing garden. Sometimes we have to go out there and just weed it out. We've got to pick the weeds. Because if we neglect it, the weeds grow. And next thing you know, we don't know when the Lord's coming or when the fruit is ready because we can't see it. Right? All right. Who likes a closing prayer? Come on up.
Daddy, that's it. Was there? Did it for mom and daddy? And did it for the Philippines and Disney man?
Amen. And on that note, we're all going to walk back to our seats quietly. Thank you. Good job, Jaden.
We are so happy this morning. We have our dear friends from Hayward. They're going to contribute to us this morning a music that will take us closer to the Lord. So we are glad that they are here, and we want to give this precious time to them.
How's everybody doing today? Man, it sounds like a funeral. I thought Savvy, you should be happy. How's everybody doing today? All right, let's try this. God is good. The roof is still up there. God is good. All the time. God is great. Every day. God is great. And every day. Amen. We should be happy because, first of all, we're here. You know, a lot of people out there didn't have the opportunity to walk back inside a sanctuary or even go back home. And we need to thank the Lord that if we are called today, we are saved. You know, because it is, sometimes it's not the second coming, it is when you are called. And make sure that when you're out of here, when you're out of this road, make sure you're in a good side with God. Amen? Amen. We're going to sing a song about how we shouldn't have enough of the Lord, and then majority of the time when we seek for help, we seek everything else, and then we come to God as our last solution, which we should go to Him before everything, because the Bible declares, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you, amen. And just as God have always been chasing after us, I hope that it is our desire to go after Him, amen.
How beautiful it is to be dwelling under your shadow, dear Lord. You're the joy of my heart and soul desire. Take this life I decide is yours. 'Cause I love to you, to seek your face, to know your grace. In this place I hunger for more of you.
I will sing of you. Thank you very much for the beautiful rendition of praise for a loving Lord, and we are glad you're here. We hope you'll come back again to sing for us here. Before I continue, I would like for us to sing our song of meditation, Come Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Is that in your church bulletin, the words? Come as a wisdom to children. Come as the sight to the blind. Come, Lord, as strength to my weakness. Take me, so body and mind. Come, Holy Spirit, I need you. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come in your strength and your power. Come in your own gentle way. Come like a spring in the desert. Sweet healing power, touch me and make me whole. Come, Holy Spirit, I need you. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come strength and your power. Come in your own gentle way. I believe that the Holy Spirit is with us this morning, friends, because the Holy Spirit will make it clear in our minds of the intention of our Redeemer, Jesus Christ, to make us whole. Without the Holy Spirit, it's impossible for us to achieve this purpose. The Holy Spirit is us, is with us. This morning, my dear friends, so we can really feel and we can experience the joy of following our Master and our Lord Jesus Christ. I just want to express my appreciation to all of you for your prayer. Because of your prayer, we are able to be back home safe and sound. There's some nervousness when you travel to the Orient and you pass by the route where the Malayan Airlines disappear. So I was looking at the map. Look at the map, and I pretty much can pinpoint, you know, where we are, you know, after we already passed this place, and oh boy, maybe this is the place. And of course, we just leave it to the Lord. You know, many of you who've been flying, and when you are in the plane, nothing much you can do but just trust the Lord and trust the pilot that will take you to your destination. Because in the plane, when you have problem, you cannot say to the pilot, can you stop for a while? You cannot do that. You just have to trust him. So from time to time, when there's some shaking, the turbulence, we just bow our heads and pray and just leave it to the Lord. And we know that he will take us to our destination. And that's why we are here, my dear friends. And I bring with me greetings from these eight churches which sponsor and really been the power of our outreach, evangelistic outreach over there. And they've been preparing before we arrive, a month before we arrived, they're already ready. And after also the presentation, at the end of the meeting, we come home, they still continue to follow up. But at the end of the meeting, we were able to bring to the Lord the soul of 202 to the Lord. And they also bring greetings, send their greetings to you through us here. How good it is to know that we are there for one purpose only, that is to tell the world, to tell the world that Jesus is coming again. When we arrive in East Indonesia, we were swamped with all the questions about what's happening in America and in the world. And they heard, of course, they read a lot about this ISIS. You know, you heard a lot about that. They heard a lot about this gruesome exercise of hatred that this group inflicted to those that they disagree and they dislike. And I saw the picture of this two reporters before their lives were taken. And also there's another one is waiting in the line for this gruesome exercise of hate. And people have been asking about this. Besides that too, they were concerned about this endemic, this Ebola. And they asked me about this, Pastor, is this the sign of the end of time? And I just told them, you just read your Bible. Because the prophecy said, Ellen White said, that you need to go to the chapter, Matthew chapter 24, and read of what's happening that there, and you learn that in the chapter, the prophecy are being fulfilled in the rapid speed. And I take them to that prophecy. They were asking also about this, what's happening about this people who hate one another, who slaughter one another, behead their enemy. And in Australia, they arrested 15 people there who were trying to just kidnap at random any people. And they want to kill them in the public. And it's good that the authority were able to intercept their plan, their what they were going to do with the people. And while we were in East Indonesia also, the authority, the security, were able to arrest about 15 people who claimed to be the members of this ISIS. And they started to say, this is North Celebes, eastern part of Indonesia. And they arrested these people because they infiltrated northern part of Indonesia and they came from southern Philippines. And, you know, it's so close. And Malaysia also arrested these people because they intended to create this confusion and havoc everywhere in this place, and hopefully they can achieve their purpose. And then with all of this, we are asking ourselves, what happens with the human race? What happened with the concern for one another? What happened with the love for one another? And you read this in chapter of Matthew 24, and you learn about what Jesus mentioned to the disciples about the end of time, just before the end. Let me read to you in Matthew chapter 24, beginning with verse 24:6. And ye shall hear wars and rumors of wars. And see that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is what? Not yet. My. So that's the end then, but not yet. For nation shall rise against nation. We know this. But I was reading in the Spirit of Prophecy, and the prophets for the remnant mentioned that we need to read closely Matthew chapter 24, because Matthew chapter 24 clearly will take us step by step about the prophecy is going to be fulfilled, and we are, as we are approaching the end of time, and after the end, when we endure, friends, and Jesus will come and take us home. That's beautiful hope there. But here again, nation shall rise against nation. We heard about this. We read about this chapter before. But I'd just like to remind us again to where we are at this time. That the prophecy is being fulfilled. It says here, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in many places. While we were there, we heard about the earthquake in Napa. We were thinking about you. 6.2 in Richter scale. And while you had here this earthquake in Indonesia also, we were resting in the 10th story of the hotel where we stayed while we were there. And we also were hit by the earthquake. Now you can imagine, you're in the 10th story. 10th story. And then you begin to feel that the building kind of sway left and right a little bit. You know. People were panicked. They wanted to run through the elevator. But the announcement came through this intercom that don't try to approach the elevator. Stay where you are and stay calm. And one of the ladies said, stay calm in this situation. How can I stay calm? Stay calm. So the fear. And you wonder, friends, about all this prophecy here. But at the same time, praise the Lord, we are told. The Master has told us about what's going to happen before the end of time. In Luke chapter 21, verse 21-25, it says, and there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations. Distress of nations. With perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. We have seen this. We have witnessed this. Men's heart failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. My friends, it is here. It is recorded so clearly here. Our Master, the warning for us here, the prophecy is being fulfilled. It means the good news is Jesus is coming soon. But before this, there's perplexity and there's distress of nation. And you look around you, friend. Look around you. Distress and perplexities. Men's heart failing them for fear, looking at those things which are coming on the earth. I'd like for you to focus on verse 28. And when these things began to come to pass, then what? Look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. So you know, well, I was watching the news and frightening news and gruesome exercise of hatred infected by man to another man. Your heart are filled with perplexities and distress. How could somebody doing this to somebody else, another human being? How could it be? The war. I was reading in the news that this group called themselves ISIS. The way they punish their enemies, crucify them. Even the children they crucified. Now you can imagine what kind of people are this. When I asked one of the pastors in Indonesia about this, what do you think? And he said, there's one thing. The devil has entered the hearts of these people. The devil is working so actively. But at the same time, we cannot just see for the bad news and frightening news, my dear friends. Because in the promises of God, in the same chapter, Jesus said, and when these things began to come to pass, these things I just mentioned to you, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. What a good news that we have. Good news that we have. While I was there, two people are asking me, Pastor, is that true that our church is Babylon? A lot of people have heard about this. I said, where did you get this? Well, some people are here and I'm preaching about it. How can you say this church is Babylon? And you know, Babylon is the kind of church or people or group who doesn't believe in the testimony of Jesus and the commandment of Jesus and persecuting the true church. This is Babylon. And we are not persecuting other church. We are people who believe, we are the remnant people who believe in the commandments of Jesus and faith in Jesus. So we are not Babylon. In Testimony to Ministers, page 117, the servant of the Lord says, the vision that Christ presented to John, presenting the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus is to be definitely proclaimed to all nations, people, and tongues. The churches presented by Babylon are presented as having fallen from their spiritual state, to become a persecuting power against those who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. This is Babylon. Fall from their spiritual state. It means they have forgotten, abandoned the commandments, the covenants of God that God established with His people. So this church is not Babylon. It is not. The churches presented by Babylon are presented as having fallen from their spiritual state to become a persecuting power against those who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. To John, this persecuting power is represented as having horns like a lamb, but as speaking like a dragon. When I mentioned this to the church, I preached to the church because they asked me, Pastor, please preach. Because we don't know what to say. They are saying that this church is Babylon. And the people who are preaching this, they are from here, from America. And praise the Lord, I was there too. I'm from America also. So they like to hear from me. And I said, you don't have to hear from me. Just hear from the words of God. I want to quote the words of God. And the testimony of Jesus and the spirit of prophecy. Friends, this is the way we defend our faith. Defend with the words of God. Defend with the spirit of prophecy that the Lord has given us. The gift for His people, the remnant. The remnant. We are the remnant who endure and waiting for Christ to come and take us home. Furthermore, she said, we are standing on the threshold, you know, the threshold, the barrier of great and solemn events. Many of the prophecies are about to be fulfilled in quick succession. Every element of power is about to be set to work. Past history will be repeated. Old controversies will arouse to new life, and peril will beset God's people on every side. Intensity is taking hold of the human family. It is permeating everything upon the earth. As we near the close of this world history, the prophecies relating to the last days demand our study. So Jesus himself said we need to look at the book of Revelation. In this case, she mentioned the messenger to the remnant mentioned. We need to look to Matthew 24. In Matthew 24, you can see, friend, the total sweep of history from Mount Olives to the end of time. And Jesus himself gave it. Tell it to his disciples. They were asking, tell us the signs of your coming. And Jesus gladly told them about the signs of the times. Matthew 24. And people were guessing, when is going to be the end? Just like when I was in Indonesia, they're asking, oh, this church is Babylon, this is the end of time. When I explained to them about what is Babylon, oh, thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Pastor. So I mentioned to them, well, the Bible says after you hear the wars and rumors of wars and pestilence and earthquakes in many places, and the Bible said, all these are what? The beginning of sorrows. Wow, it's only the beginning. So you are wondering, Lord, can I make it or not? Friends, of course we can make it. If we trust the Lord, trust His word. It's like the lyric of the songs. Old song in gospel melodies. I like that words. Trust and what? Obey. For there is no other way to be happy in Jesus and to trust and obey. I enjoy the song that our group sang just now. You know, let's uplift Jesus. Bring focus to what we need to do, what we need to look at the end of our life here on earth. So Jesus mentioned to the people in this prophecy, this is just the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated to all nations for my name's sake. You're not going to be popular to become a Christian. To believe in Jesus, to believe in the commandments of Jesus, you're not going to be popular. Well, nowadays, you're being protected. You're protected. You're a Christian, you're being protected by the law. But someday, this protection is going to disappear. And you're going to stand by yourself with your faith in Jesus. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. Here we see it, what's happening in the world today. The hate. The hate. And many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. This is what we are witnessing today. Iniquity is abound. The love of many is wax cold. People taking somebody's life, other's life at random. They don't know that people, that person. But they plan to kill them. And we are living where iniquity abounds. And the love of many shall wax cold. The question, my dear friends, is how about us here? How about us? How about our love to one another? That is important. Forget about what's happening there. They're killing one another. Planning to kill and take somebody's life at random. But for God's people, how about our love to one another? And our love to Jesus. That's why my topic this morning is we have our ministry. When I was reading newspaper, watching this news and television about this frightening, gruesome exercise of hate in a certain part of the world, and I thought, praise the Lord, we have our ministry. Paul said this ministry, the ministry is a ministry of reconciliation. It's our ministry. This is the gospel. The proclamation of the gospel. It says here, But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be what? Saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached into all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. You want to guess when is the end? It's when the gospel of the kingdom has been preached to all the nation of the world. And then the end come. It means the door is closed. And Jesus will come and take his people home. So friends, praise the Lord for our ministry. I want to read again what Paul says. Because surrounded by hatred and misconception about the meaning of God. You know, people who are killing one another, they call also they believe in God, Allah. Is that the way really to believe in God? Paul mentioned here the ministry and please open with me in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Chapter 5. Verse 14. For the love of Christ constraineth us. Because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we were all dead. But I want you to jump to verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he shall be a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Beautiful. This is the ministry that we need to have. The ministry of reconciliation. Reconciliation to one another, and reconciliation to our Savior, to our loving God. I was thinking about this when I was in the plane and thinking about what shall I preach when I first Sabbath at home here, looking what's happening around in this world. Friends, I decided I want to come back to the focus of our ministry. It's the love of God that constrained us, that called us, and the ministry that we have, none other, that ministry of reconciliation. We need to have that. Reconciliation to one another and reconciliation to Jesus Christ, our loving God. So then the question here is, if the good news is that Jesus is coming again, are we ready when he comes? We need to be ready. How we can be ready? I want to make a suggestion. First, our mindset to always be ready. Mindset should always be ready. State of our mind. Maybe it's just like the Israelites of old. They came out of Egypt, marching to direction to the promised land. But when they were marching forward, they were marching to the promised land with a retreating mind. You follow me? Because they were thinking about Egypt. They were thinking about all the life they had over there. Now they were following Moses in the wilderness. So they keep following him, but the mind is there. Friends, this is not the mindset for those who are heading for the promised land. The same for us here today. Philippians 2:5. You want to read with me? Philippians 2:5. Talk about the mind of Christ. 2:5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. The mind of Christ, friends, the mind of Christ, be our mind, the state of our mind, the mindset, looking forward. You have Jesus. And secondly, we need to have ongoing relationship with Jesus, ongoing. It means you should be active all the time, all the way. It's like people say today, we need not just talk the talk. We need to walk the walk. 2 Timothy 1:12. I want you to read that if you have your Bible with me. Read with me. 2 Timothy 1:12-14. This is about ongoing relationship with Jesus. Paul had this mindset. 12:14. For the which I also, cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I'm not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Suppose that hold fast the form of the sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. That good things which was committed unto thee keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. And next, always living for him. For him. Titus chapter 2. I would like for you to read this Titus chapter 2. Titus 2:11-13. For the grace that brings salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. 13. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, always living for Him. And Apostle Paul made a suggestion here. It means that not just living and looking. He didn't say living or looking. Living or looking. No, living and looking. You're living and looking ahead. Always living for Him. And the last one is in Hebrews 12, verse 1 and 2. We need to run with patience, looking to the author and finisher of our faith. Hebrews 12. Verse 1 and 2. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Friends, we need to run with patience, the race. This is a good analogy here. In our own life, Christian life, we are moving forward. We are walking toward the promised land. Let us run with patience. Just like this athlete, run with patience. A lot of pressure is coming around us. Stress. What do? We need to run with patience. Looking ahead. And says here, looking unto Jesus, the author of the and finisher of our faith. It means when you run with patience, you also need to look unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Don't look around. Look to yourself. Looking unto Jesus. So I thought about this, and what is important for us, friends, as we journey in this life, waiting for our Lord to come. We need to journey with patience and always looking unto Jesus, and to think that He's the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. How good it is to think that we have our Jesus ahead of us, that we can focus on. My dear friends, in this life, as the people of the Advent waiting for the Lord to come, we are grateful. You know, we have a peaceful country now. We can worship freely and peacefully. Nobody bother us. Think about those, the Christians over there in northern Iraq. Think of those in western Syria over there. There are many Christians. They're running. They don't know where to go. When a reporter asked one of the Christians who was on the mountain, because they tried to get away from those who are persecuting them. So the reporter asked him, "When are you going next? Where are you going next?" And he said, "I don't know. We've been running. for so long. There's no place now for us to hide. So what are you going to do? We don't know. We just pray the Lord, to the Lord. Friends, compared to us here, my, we have a place for worship. Nobody is bothering us. We still have the freedom. But if you follow closely the prophecy, my dear friends, we are learning, someday, the freedom that we have, we are going to lose it. The only thing that we have is our faith to endure until the end. So Hebrews says here in 10:35, cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of a reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, and if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. So again, 35, I want to repeat here, and 36. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, that's one thing which is important. We need to do the will of God. That's important, the will of God. After that, and then ye might receive the promise. And what's the promise, my dear friends? Eternal life. Joy. Happiness and peace. Eternal life. You cannot count the years of eternal life, eternity. But the most important for us is not just thinking about that length of time, but the chance for us to meet Jesus, to meet Jesus and be with Him forever. And this is my prayer for all of you. Shall we close our worship service by singing Wake the Song, number 34 of our church hymnal, Wake the Song. 34. Shall we stand as we sing, please? Wake the song of joy and glad, heard the dead noble slays, banish every thought of sadness, pouring forth the highest praise. Sing to Him whose care has brought us once again with friends to meet, and whose loving voice had taught us of the way to Jesus' feet. Wake the song, the song of joy and gladness. Wake the song of jubilee. The last stanza. Thanks to Thee, O Holy Father, for the mercies of the year. May its heart swell with gratitude sincere. Thanks to Thee, O loving Savior, for redemption through Thy blood. Breathe upon us, Holy Spirit. wake the song of joy and gladness. Wake the song of jubilee. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, precious Lord, we are so thankful and grateful for the promise that you have given us, Lord. We are so thankful for the Sabbath. Thankful, Lord, for the hymns, the prayer, and your words, Lord. May your words affect our lives so we can walk closer to you more than ever before. Dismiss us from this place, Lord, with your blessing, the blessing of joy. Forgive our sins in Jesus' most worthy and precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Be seated, please.